wondered how your online activity may affect your ability to obtain credit? I'm Anouk Ruyak, a Mozilla Fellow in Residence working on data stewardship, and I'm going to explain the surprising ways in which social media might affect your finances. Take a moment to consider how much of your life takes place online. We shop online, meet friends online, read the news online, we even go to the doctor online. And while we do all those things, we leave a trail of data behind. Tweets, posts, pictures, but also the number of times we've consulted a medical website, signed up for a language course, or booked a plane ticket. This matters because some companies exist for the sole purpose of collecting all the data that you leave online and then sell it to whomever pays. These companies are called data brokers. They follow you around as you go from one website to another and store all the data you leave behind. On their own, these data points say very little about you. But when you combine all that information, suddenly you're able to tell things about your political beliefs, your religion, gender, age, your sexual preferences, your financial status. You may even be able to predict whether you're going to get married soon or whether you're currently pregnant. And that's exactly what happens. Data brokers use that information to build extensive profiles about you, although these profiles are often incorrect. For example, data brokers like Axiom and Equifax hold data about thousands of millions of people living in the United States, and not just a little bit of data, they hold thousands of attributes per person. You want a loan? The bank would like to know how likely you are to repay that loan. And that seems fair, but the question is, how do they decide that? And the answer really depends on where you are in the world. In some countries, bank and other loan providers can only look at your official credit scores, which is based on your financial history. How much money you have in your bank account, whether you have outstanding loans, whether you ever defaulted on your loans, whether you're up to date with your credit payments, etc. A lot can be said about the fairness of credit scores, but at the very least, they are based on information relative for the question at hand, whether you can and will repay a loan. But not everyone has such an extensive financial history. You may just have gotten your first credit card or never had a credit card at all. And you may live in a country without clear rules about how credit scores can be calculated. In those cases, your credit score could be based on just about anything. What you post on social media, whether you recently visited a doctor, whether you live in a healthy neighborhood. Suddenly, your most recent Google search history or your latest post on TikTok can prevent you from getting a loan. And how do loan providers get this information about you? Exactly, data brokers. This isn't hypothetical either. There are loan providing apps in, for instance, India that automatically calculate whether or not you are eligible for a loan and at what rate. These automated calculations are based on hundreds of data points about you, including what you post on social media, financial transactions, location data, or Google searches. Yes, you could be more careful about what you post online, but this would likely not be enough. Not everything about you online is correct, and neither is the data collected by data brokers. They may have found a post written by someone with the same name as you and simply assumed it was you. Or someone may have said something about you online that wasn't correct. But you have no way of knowing and no way of correcting this information. And it gets worse. A lot of these decisions are made by machines that use complicated algorithms to decide whether or not you are eligible for a loan. So complex, in fact, that it's often impossible for a human to understand how they arrived at their decision. So how do we know that the decision was fair and based on relevant information? The convoluted nature of these algorithms also means that it's very easy for bias or outright discrimination to seep in and stay hidden. In many countries, it's illegal to discriminate on the basis of, for instance, age or race, gender or religion. But companies can and do sneak in discrimination through the back door. And they do that by using proxies. For instance, the social media platform that you use can tell me a lot about your age, And so it becomes a proxy for age, and we start to be able to discriminate against that. Finally, if an algorithm decides that you're not eligible for a loan, that information is stored as well. And that on its own can lower your credit score, thereby making it harder to obtain a loan in the future. So to recap, even if your online behavior is exemplary, whatever that means, it's possible that loan providers have bought inaccurate information about you from data brokers. Their algorithms may be biased against you getting a loan based on your age, sex, or the color of your skin. And if they deny you a loan, that can make it harder for you to get a loan in the future. What can you do about this? You can start by researching and knowing your rights. How creditworthiness is calculated varies wildly from country to country. Countries like the US have laws that dictate what credit scores can be based on. In some countries, you will have the right to have your data protected from unauthorized sales by third parties. Or you may have the right to inspect what a data broker holds about you. If an algorithm has decided to deny you a loan, in some countries, you have the right to know how the machine reached that decision. Knowing your rights and who to contact when they are violated can help you appeal decisions you do not agree with. But what if your rights aren't well protected in the country you live in? Many organizations around the globe are working hard to change the situation. Examples include Access Now, which works globally, as do Privacy International and Mozilla. All have frequent campaigns you can join and petitions you can sign. Other examples include the Electronic Freedom Frontier in the US, Adrian Europe, CPACE in East and Southern Africa, and Derechos Digitales in Latin America.